Hi, I'm Shaikh Jalal from Fat Cat Motorsports, and I want to talk about, fairly briefly, about why I believe every engineer needs to have some degree of liberal arts experience. Engineering principles and scientific principles can exist on their own. They can be theoretical. You can also apply many of them, most of them probably. And there's sometimes a little bit of a trepidation to take something out of a lab into the real world because, you know, there's so many more real variables than you can often account for. And that's why safety margins, safety factors exist, right? Sometimes, you know, the tsunami wall is not as high as you need. It accounts for 70% of cases, but you get an outlier event and, oops, you got a problem. So I've learned a lot by taking suspension tuning and applying it, you know, to track, to back roads, and take always empirically testing what you're doing. So like the shock dyno itself is not all you're relying on. And also just not just see the pants, so it's really both. So it's the application and the integration of what you do in the class, in the lab, in the shop, to the real world that really matters. And in the real world, you have real people using your devices, using your creations. And then if they're buying from you or they're interacting with you, then you have those real world interactions, you know, conversations and needs and desires and wants and hopes and fears and dreams and all that stuff that someone's bringing to you when they're saying, I want to buy something from you, or I want you to design something for me. And having the ability to relate to people from an emotional level, not just the I can create a solution to your problem because I know enough. It's I can at least identify with some of what you've experienced in your life, whoever you are, whoever we're talking to. And there's something really, really, it's amazing that, you know, like apprenticing, this idea of apprenticing. And I mean, education is wonderful. University degrees can be very empowering and useful, and you can learn important, you know, important details and techniques. There's a sense of credentialing of, you know, yeah, I belong to this tribe now. You know, I'm an engineer. I'm a accountant. You know, I'm an artist. I mean, that's actually maybe where it becomes less useful. In fact, maybe you better stay away from university if you are really an artist. But actually, that's what I'm talking about, is because I came into this suspension design area as a maverick, just I gave myself permission, as I talked about in the 59-minute video that I just recorded before this one. You have to be a little, to really make some type of a useful impact. I mean, if you end up just plugging into a system and you are there and that's cool with you, then that's great. You know, as long as you're happy with what you're doing, that's what really matters. And I also know that when I talk to an egghead, I'm just going to use that word, okay, that it's a little frustrating. It's sort of like, have you ever been in love? Have you ever crashed a car? You know, have you ever had to wonder where your next meal or maybe where your next month's rent's going to come from? You know, have you ever had to babysit a kid that was screaming and you don't know why? You're like, when are the parents coming back? You know, I did that when I was like 13 or 14 or 15. I don't think I was even 18. Maybe I was 18. I probably was 18, but it was like, oh my God, what am I doing here? I didn't think $40 was going to be this hard to make. It's like the real world is not equations and solutions. It's messy, and it's complicated. You know, as opposed to complex. Like equations can be complex, most of them. you get nonlinear equations, you know, you got to use really sophisticated complex methods to solve them, you know, modeling dynamic systems and things like that. And so how do you, to relate to a complicated situation, I would say, I feel that you have to be able to be in your emotional nature to feel the stress, feel the pressure, feel the tension, and to just let it move you, to let it inspire you in a way. Like going to a race in real life is different than lining up with your friends on Forza or whatever and racing for the comfort of your home. You know, and you're all congratulating yourselves, yay, you know, fastest one. It's like, you know, get your helmet, get your car, you know, make sure your brakes are in good shape, make sure your lug nuts are tight, you know, make sure your battery's not going to fly around and bang around or whatever. Make sure you don't have Windex on your foot pedals slipping off of them. I mean, the real world has got all these little things going on. And, like, I was talking about dancing in the beginning. Dancing is a wonderful metaphor for that sense of really being in the experience, you know, like just really letting yourself move and whatever you're feeling, expressing yourself in that way. And like every emotion, there's probably some associated dance move with it, you know. So even if you just do it at home, okay, you don't want to go out maybe, but at some point doing it with other people, around other people, is more symbolic of how do you interact with people in the real world. It's very easy for somebody who's extremely intelligent and has limited real life experience to be arrogant and to, maybe they can create things great in isolation in a comfortable lab and a comfortable shop behind, you know, a desk and they're designing something or whatever. But there's going to be something about what they're creating that lacks heart, and people will not connect with it. And people may not connect with you. And there's already so many areas of the world that really could use compassionate engineering, that creating another generation of disembodied engineers, just like, you know, egg-heady, like, I'm going to put my bring my head to work and I'm going to leave the rest of me out of it, other than when I need to eat and pee and whatever. It's like, no, we really need your whole self to show up to work, to what you're doing, to show up to your avocation. And so apprenticing, as I mentioned, and I was talking to people, because there was a conversation that happened, it was yesterday. It was actually a friend of mine who has a brilliantly talented son. I think he's 14. He's an amazing drummer, amazing musician, talent. And he started with drums first. Now he's getting into guitar and bass and guitar. He's already writing songs. And he was struggling with learning notes. If he hears something or if he just wants to create on his own, just brilliant. Really, really talented. All genres. I mean, he's just, whatever rhythms he wants to create just come out, just, you know, flow out of him. It's amazing. And so you're struggling with learning notes. And I mean, I believe he's going to get it. I mean, to me, there's no doubt he is. But he's sort of beating himself up for it. Like somebody was saying, oh, you can't be in a band if you don't know how to read notes and da-da-da. I'm like, bullshit. You can't start a company if you don't have an engineering degree. Really? Knock on wood. There's some wood. Yeah. So far, so good, you know? Credentialing is not the mark of ability and results. And my suggestion was to simply give yourself time to adapt to something else. You know, take in that skill set. And then it'll become unconscious competence at some point. Right now, it's conscious incompetence. Like, I don't really get this. So there's these four layers of you know, mastery, right? There's unconscious, incompetence. Unconscious incompetence. You don't know that you're not good at something. Conscious incompetence. You know that you're not getting it done. You know that you're not able to get these results. Then you start to achieve competence. So it's like there's this dividing line. You're now in incompetence. But it's conscious competence. So you're actively aware, like, I am apexing. I am breaking at the marker that I've set up for myself, you know, because my coach and during the walkthrough, like, this is where I'm going, like, this is an important stage in many cases. And then you get to unconscious competence where you're just, and that's mastery. You know, you're just, you are able to deliver at any moment, given time, this performance, and you're engaged in something so that it's not even conscious at all. And that's magic, and that's art, and that's flow. So people who emphasize conscious competence may not necessarily be able to themselves step into the unconscious competence realm, the magic of that. If they can, then that's great. But, and I also really believe that people who emphasize skill training and emphasize, you know, you must learn these principles, you must have this project, and you're going to have to get this result to get your degree or pass this class, that there has to be, for this really to be, for any discipline, and especially I think a science, maybe liberal art too in a way, but really a science where there are definable goals and outcomes, and, you know, this equation has this solution, and you might be able to get there in different ways, but there is a solution, or maybe two if you've got an imaginary and a real part, you know. That getting to the unconscious competence where it's effortless, that has to be a whole body experience. It can't be intellectual. It, in fact, the less that you feel your brain is in charge of the process, the more effortless it is, and the more, in a way, beautiful the result will be. And it does take time and attention and focus on that. And I also really believe it takes just literally moving your body. Like, I know when I'm really having a really vital conversation with someone, I have to move. I have to stand up and move around. Like, even you see how animated I am just sitting here. I know that my body knows things. And when I'm in it and I'm expressing myself through it, then I know what it knows. I'm getting what it's, I'm aware of what it knows within itself. And that's an amazing feeling. It's really amazing. And I've done a lot of dance. And I enjoy piano and singing. I don't sketch that great, although I do like to, and I want to do more. I'd love to do more like oil painting. I mean, I love, you know, real art. I have this picture on the wall here, which it's this guy in Paris, actually. I was there in 2008, and this, I can unplug this. So this piece is... there it is right there. Yeah, it may not be beautifully lit or whatever, but it just, you know, a guy outside the Louvre was putting his work up. And too chaotic, that's probably about the same. And it was really, I loved it. I got one for my mom and one for me. There's different painting. I think I'm out of focus. So. And you know that somebody doing this has got to, you know, he wasn't, I mean, just a painter. I mean, an artist is observing all of life. You know, you're into pretty much everything. A great engineer, a great designer, like Frank Lloyd Wright, you know, do you think he couldn't have done what he did by just staying inside an architectural office? I mean, the whole point of what his works were is this is integrated with nature, you know? yeah, so this is, you know, please use your body. Use your body. If you're in school, take an art class, take a dance class, take a piano class, do a sport if you want. And especially, I really believe that social dance, because you do get that, I mean, you get that really awesome interaction, you know, with girls your age, learning the lead and follow, and especially to me in the suspension side of things, of feeling what that, you know, what just the right amount of tension is, you know, not too loose and not too rigid, just finding that nice, you know, flow back and forth, what the dance is. There's so many parallels to life. And then when you interact with someone, I mean, as they say, 70% of communication is nonverbal. 60%, 70%, 80%, whatever it is, it's basically way more than half is nonverbal. And if you're really just sharing from your head, then you are losing 70% of, you are not presenting the 70% of yourself that people want to and need to get from you. You're missing out on a real true connection. And that person that you're talking to may know someone who can help you get that internship or that job or provide you with some insight or a, hey, you might want to check this thing out. But they're just going to have this talking head to a degree coming at them. And they're just like, whoa. And they'll just be politely nodding, listen to you. And it's like, oh my God, I don't want to talk to this person again. You know, it's like, oh, I see you at a party. Oh, hey, what's up? Bye. I've been there. I've been that person. People, I could see them, like their eyes, like, yeah, you know, they're just like, I want to get out of here. And it's kind of hurts at first. Then you realize, well, maybe you can think, what am I doing that's making people not want to be around me? What am I, is it my verbal diarrhea that they don't want to clean up or deal with? And I do really recommend meditation. Really, breath work. If you look up Alan Watkins, Being Brilliant Every Single Day on YouTube, and he has his breath pacer, which he developed, he and his company. And I used to use that one, and now I use this one from Institute of Heart Math. It's called the EM Wave 2, which I think they have an even newer version. And this is even better, in my opinion, because this bottom part, so actually this is the right, correct orientation. Is there still juice? Oh good, it's still got juice. It actually lasts quite a long time. So this has got a little LED, an IR sensor, an LED, IR LED, and the sensor embedded here. So once I put my finger over it, it's going to start to note my pulse, which is at the bottom. So let me do it this way. Actually, no, I'll do it this way. So there it is, and that's my pulse at the bottom. And as I'm breathing, it's sort of tracking my... This is actually, I think the pacer is just going up and down. Like this is exhale... and inhale. And then at the top it's showing my level of coherence, and this is heart rate variability is what this ties into. Before a test, before something stressful going on in your life, especially tests, to say this is really it's on focal mode. I'll just let it go. And actually, when you talk, if you talk a lot, it's not always easy to stay coherent, which is another reason. Coherence is crucial. But when you're speaking from your heart, and maybe this is the best reason that you need to care about this, when you speak from your heart and not from your head, you're really reaching people. Like, these are the people that you want to have around you, that you want to listen to, that you want to care about. Surprisingly coherent for talking, so this is good. Now that I say it, it might turn red. And this has been a lot of what the last couple months has been about for me. It's doing my best to remain in a centered place so that when I'm... how I'm interacting is really communicating that I care and that I also have discernment. Like, I'm not just open to everyone and everything. I'm discerning the right opportunities, the right people. I can discern the right connections. I'm not feeling pressured to be a certain way or be in a certain place. And when you're authentic, I mean, that's the buzzword that people have used for a long time. It's a good one. When you're being true to yourself, you know, your engineering studies, your science studies are a small part of your whole life. You know, you've got hobbies and interests, you've got friends, you've got favorite movies and music and memories and places you want to visit and places you have been to. Like, all of that is so important and it's so real and it's so necessary that in some way you're infusing what you do with who you really are. Beyond, I'm an engineer. People need to feel your heart. You need to feel your heart and your joy. And, you know, in whatever way, you might be a little bit off and different and goofy and funny. Because, I mean, engineers and scientists, we often are the means to which change occurs in the world. You know, we can interact with matter. We can shape matter to be what we want it to be. And what we envision it to be. And if we envision from an open heart, from an open mind that's coherent, okay, I'm talking more so it's getting red. When we envision from a heart that's connected to the mind, which is what this breath pacing, this heart rate variability is about. It's oxygenating your brain fully so that your full brilliant capacity will arise. And then brilliance is effortless. Genius is effortless. Creativity is effortless. It just arises because you created a space to be creative and brilliant and inspired. That's the greatest part about being an engineer. You know, you are your own engine inside yourself. And it's really is about connecting to the world. Like, whatever you develop, it's going to have to be born, right? Something's going to be put into the world. And I like the analogy of making love, of creating a baby, that babies don't just pop into existence. There had to be two people that decided to spend time only with each other in a particular way, particular dynamic, two-body interaction. Yes, I'm talking about this, yeah. And it's an intensity, a focus, and ideally love. And that's what creation is about. And I hope that most of us have been, and what we conceive of will be born from love. Because that's what makes the world a richer, more beautiful place, is what we're putting our love and our heart into space, into space-time. Like, here I am, a being in space-time, you know. You know, I'm here or I'm not here. You're here or you're not here. You know, it's an amazing, I use that word and it's true, it's amazing to be. And like, what do we do with our being? You know, a human being, not just a human doing. Our being is love and curiosity and compassion and creativity. So please infuse your science and your math and your engineering and your business degree and anything with art. You know, just like I would encourage a business person to learn some algebra, to be able to calculate percentages without needing a calculator, you know, to round up to the nearest $5 and then 10% of that, and then double that if it's good service, you know. It's just, you know, balancing. Balancing and really integrating ourselves. I mean, yes, it is about balancing. It's also about stretching. You know, it's like if you're afraid to like lift your arms over your head when you're dancing, you know, then that's what you need to practice doing, you know, to really, that's what being fully in yourself is. You know, if you're afraid to spin out on the autocross course, you're not going to get as fast as you could otherwise be, you know, or at the track, but you know, whatever environment you feel comfortable stepping into. So you guys, all of you, guys and gals, are if you're reading, if you're watching this, and if you're 30 or younger, I'm 40. In chronological years, I usually act between 6 and 10, 12. You all are the future that is going to be making this world into the better place that it can be, that it needs to be. There has been enough, disconnected, ed-hegging going on since the Industrial Revolution. Some good things have happened. Many not so good things have happened. Many, many harmful things have happened. There's a lot more consciousness these days about the impact that we're making. And your art, music, literature, I think I was talking about Terence McKenna in the other video, and he said, he's an amazing being, really insightful psychonaut, dove into all kinds of psychedelics and came back to talk about his experiences and what he learned from them. And he said, we are here to make art. Your art, whatever your art is. I don't know. Do you know? If you don't, that's okay. Explore. Is Your Genius at Work is another wonderful book, a wonderful resource for that. And this whole theme to me is about, again, dancing, movement, art, sports, yes. And also, sports tend to be goal-oriented. That's something that it's fun to talk about, yeah, no doubt. Although I haven't really been following sports, so I don't even know. I mean, the Warriors were in the finals. I didn't even know. So, cool. They all won. This is great. I'd rather talk about a piece that I'm working on, or I'd share with someone and say, hey, let's sing a song together, or whatever. Like, I like to make art with people. This is also why when I'm making a suspension, you and I are having a dance of this is what you're looking for, and this is what I can, what I know, what I believe I can do for you, and we're creating this work of art together. That's why it is a collaboration. Like, you're my sponsor, you are the patron for me. And yeah, so there's so much more than just, God, this is a 27, okay, all right, so this is going to be half as long as the other one. And it's a really important one for you folks. I really hope you can feel, I hadn't done dance for a long time until last, this year it was in spring semester. I took a class at a local community college, and it was a salsa class, and I loved it. And I had forgotten how much fun it was to get a good sweat, to connect with, with women, of all ages. I danced with, grandmothers in their 70s probably, to, one girl I think who was, not even 18 yet. And she's there with her parents, which was great. Her parents were dancing, and they didn't want to leave her home, so they brought her in. And just having so much fun, just really... I definitely am not an expert salsa dancer, but when I got comfortable with at least a few of the moves, I was like doing the chicken dance and all this stuff, and just being a goofball with the right partner, that's where it's really, really fun. It's, we can get our work done. We know we can be focused and dedicated and, smart and do all that stuff. It's like, what about the rest of you? What about that fun, crazy, what's your secret accent that you can do that nobody knows about, or the funny sound, or the joke, or you can bend your finger all the way back, or you're double jointed, whatever it is that's something unusual and funny and silly about you and cool, that's what needs to be infused into you showing up in the world. So that when we meet you, we're feeling that 70% of you, that you're beyond what you're saying. And then what you're saying is in harmony with what you're expressing through your body, that you're being completely yourself and authentic, including what you don't know, what you aren't sure of yet, and being okay not knowing, because trust me, there's tons of things that I don't know that I still have to double check and question about. And when you can be comfortable in uncertainty, not so much fear to a degree, but fear needs to be examined. It's an opportunity to examine something when you feel fear, because that's false evidence appearing real, as one acronym someone said. If there is actually a bear around the corner, then you got to pay attention, and if there is, then you do what you have to do. If you're not sure and you're just going to worry, but you're not going to check, then you've put yourself, you've trapped yourself. You are in the trap that the bear would have otherwise fallen into, but it's this trap. So I really encourage you to look for places where you are afraid, whether it's public speaking. That was a big one for me for a long time. Really, really big one. I stuttered when I was a kid for a while. I didn't at first, and then I had this. I showed in the other video, I think. Or actually, no, I didn't. Yeah, this is, maybe I did. That was me at like 3 years old. That little lip thing happened because I tried to jump through a window in my parents' house in the living room. And I didn't make it. I just hit the windowsill instead. And all this other stuff happened around it. And because of those experiences, I became really introverted and really self-critical and self-doubting and just completely my worst enemy. But it really gave me a lot of understanding later on as I started to come out of it. And I could feel like this isn't really who I am. I didn't know how to arrive through it. But that was this journey I had to go through. And all the things that I'm talking about are things that I've had to do myself to become comfortable just being natural. Like, I never do more than one take unless I've been interrupted and it's too weird an interruption. And this is the transmission I'm giving to you, is that life is not about doing retakes. Life is not about, you know, endless respawns and resaves, which I've used very liberally in various games that I've played. I really feel it's better to just say, you know, one shot, you know, one go, you know, one shot, one kill, or, you know, one go, just dive into it. David Data, I'll mention him now. There's a couple videos that I'll link to below. One of them is Spirit, Sex, Love, which is an interesting one about masculine and feminine polarities and dynamics. And he shows, like, what does it mean to be masculine? You know, masculine man, feminine woman. And in general, what does masculinity look like? If you're a masculine woman and, you know, you're going to be attracted to a feminine man, and then if that's really how you're comfortable being, you know, how does that interaction work? How do you both really embody that fullness? And for me, my goal, my presentation is as a masculine man, very comfortable with my feminine qualities, my feminine side. And I want a feminine woman. And so when I am interacting with a woman, you know, I bring and I feel that my awareness and my presence of her and paying attention to her and what's happening with her, like, that's something I really got to learn more with dance. It's like I had 30 different partners in my dance class. And some were 5 foot, some were 5'9", some were, you know, wider than others. You know, how do I move to get around them? Can they do this double turn, or can they only do a single turn? You know, are they feeling my lead well, or do I really have to, can I lead them on a, you know, inside turn, or they can't get the inside turn? I have to just kind of go into that through, you know, hammer lock or something. I mean, it is amazing to feel the dynamic of what the real world is. And in an environment where it's safe. And so if you're in school and if you haven't taken a social dance class yet, do it. I could sum it up in that. Like, dance. Learn to dance with choreography to develop that conscious competence. And if you decide you want to keep going, or you feel enough of it, and you will have dances. And that, to me, is really that the highlight, is when I just am with a partner who just flows. And I've had a few dances, and there's one girl in particular I know who actually wasn't even very experienced, but she just was so lithe and graceful and just effortlessly followed my lead. And she gave me permission to experiment and just try things that I couldn't do with other people. Because we were really connected. And we didn't date. I never even got her phone number. You know, we just would meet there and we would talk. And it was just wonderful connection and inspiration. And absolutely improved my sense of my work, or, you know, like, yeah, I want my car to feel like that kind of a dance, you know, like I'm in love with my car, I'm in love with the way it feels and it rides and it handles. So dance, you know, push yourself, challenge yourself. You will be happier for it. It's worth taking another semester, you know, like do it while you're in all your major classes. I was talking to my assistant about this. So I told him he's inspired me to do a video about this. I don't know if he's going to watch it or not. He might. I'm not sure if he's subscribed, but, and I probably go on these things ad nauseum with him, and I have to be aware, like, okay, I've said enough. Speaking as an extrovert and a very strong introvert starting college, you know, and I took the social dance class with my girlfriend, and then later I took it by myself, but with a friend of mine. It has brought me into wonderful friendships, really, really deep connections. I've met some wonderful girlfriends that way too. And ultimately, when I started to get into ecstatic dance, which is another thing that's really like free form, you know, very, very free form, it's truly liberating to just let your body do what it wants to do, so that the steps are fine to begin with, and maybe you want to continue with it. But ultimately, you know, life is not scripted. So dances, I don't feel really, to be real, they can't be scripted. They have to just be spontaneous. And that's when you're expressing yourself in life. And that, you know, yeah, engineering is, and science are part of the movement of life. And you have to be integrated with life for that to be meaningful. Thanks for your attention. Dance.